Oh, good morning. How's everybody? I have a hard time every Sunday counting to four. I don't know why. I don't know what it is, but I turned to Tracy and I'm like, was that four? And then Cody looks at me and she goes, yeah, that was four. You know, so I guess we both do. But anyways, good to see all of y'all this morning. Ronnie, is it working? Do what? Okay, I tell you what, man, everything was working good this morning. I don't know what happened after Gene got here, but then it all went kapooey. But anyway, I'm blaming you, Gene. Guys, thank y'all for being here. We have got an amazing treat in store for you today. If you've never seen what Corey's going to share with us, man, here in just a little while, you'll be blessed. I promise you, very talented young man. Before I get to him, next Sunday we've got our Thanksgiving lunch. We're providing the meat and the drinks and that good stuff. Bring some side dishes, veggies. If you volunteered to cook a turkey, ham, dressing, or whatever, get with Melissa afterwards, and she can get all that stuff to you, pans, whatever, everything that you need. The Double End Angel Tree, the Buckaroo Tree, and that's going to be list. If you need some help there with that this year, we need your list by November the 29th. No children's church today, kids. Y'all are going to stay in here. If you need a bag, there's some activity bags over there by the tee and everything. If you need something to keep your kiddos busy or whatever, you can do that. But I promise you, you're not there. They're going to pay attention, Corey. I promise you, man. I promise you. I've known this guy since where's your family at? Where are they at? Oh, there y'all are right over there. My goodness. Good to see ya. Good to see ya. You know, I remember when Corey was a seventh grader. Yeah. I can tell you some stories. Because that's about the time we met, wasn't it? You know, when he was in the seventh grade, man, and God had just saved me, and it's so amazing. Anytime you can see someone like this that God has just done some amazing stuff with, blessed him with a talent he's gonna knock your socks off. I know, brother. When it's your time, whatever God has laid on your heart, man, hit us with both barrels. All right, and we're definitely gonna be praying for y'all. Corey does come on a love offering basis. This is how he serves, but it's also his living, how he provides for his family. There's a boot on both the offering tables, guys. We want to bless him today. Okay, we want to bless him. You know, here's the other thing about this. For some of us old school people, some of us older ones, all right, or let me say more mature ones. How about that? More mature ones. We a lot of us grew up with a lot of evangelists and stuff, and going to week-long revivals and all that sort of stuff, where guys, man, they made their living sharing the gospel, investing in all of us. And you know, we know how COVID has affected us this year. Corey speaks at a lot of camps. He goes on a lot of mission trips, sharing the gospel all over the place. And so he's one of those guys that's been affected too. We want to bless him this morning. If you want to give something to him, those boots are there. If you put it in the boot, it's going to go straight to them. So you know, just keep that in mind before you leave today and everything. Okay. All right. You know, y'all are blessed. You know that, because this will be 2 weeks in a row you don't have to listen to me. How about that? That's good, isn't it? That's good. That's good. I'm feeling, man, I'm coming with both barrels next week, I promise you, so you better get ready. Let me pray with us, and then I'm going to sit down and be quiet, and the band's going to continue to lead us in worship. And brother, looking forward to what God's got for us today through you, okay? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for just the opportunity to be able to gather up here this morning. Lord, I praise you for technology issues. Lord, because if I don't praise you, man, I'm gonna get all up in myself and in my flesh. Father, I know it's a glitch, and Lord, at the end of the day, it's gonna be okay no matter what. And so Father, we just we're gonna pray this morning, Lord, that everyone that needs to hear this, Lord, even see this, Father, that the way is made for that to take place. God, I thank you for each and every one that's here this morning. Lord, I praise you for those that are going to see this tonight, Lord, tomorrow, next week, whenever it may be. And Father, I pray, Lord, that lives are touched. But God, more importantly, Father, I pray that lives are changed. Father, we continue to lift this country up to you, Lord, this nation. Lord, the division that's out there. God, we continue to come to your throne and pray for your peace. Lord, we continue to pray for your guidance. Lord, we continue to pray, Lord, for for your will. Father, for your will. Father, bless us this morning. Keep us safe. And God, may everything that we do bring you honor, glory, and praise. Jesus, it's in your name we pray. Amen. Corey, you need this moved?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. y'all pray with me? Lord, thank you for everything you do for us. I pray that everything that happens here today is for you and from you, and I pray that you would just open our hearts to receive it. It's in your Son's precious name I pray. Amen.
All right, you guys doing good? All right, all right. Hey, if you got your Bible, turn with me to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, you can turn there. I hope and pray you came with an expecting heart to see God work and move in a mighty powerful way. It's not about me. I want to hide behind the cross and take you guys to Jesus, okay? Romans chapter 12, again, is where you guys are turning. I pray and hope that we just are able to dive into God's word and allow him to speak to our hearts, okay? I will tell you guys, Brother Jimmy was somebody who invested in my life, very instrumental in my life, in my walk with Christ. I learned at a young age, seventh grade, that if God could use him, God can use anybody, right, church? He did pour into my life, loved on me, tackled me playing basketball, things of that nature. And so it's just thank you for what you've done for us and for our ministry, okay? So I'm excited about being here with you guys this morning. I pray and hope, again, that you came here with the attitude of saying, man, I want to see what God has for me, okay? So we're already worshiped him through prayer. We've already worshiped him through singing and whatnot. Right now, we're going to dive into God's word, okay? And I'll give you some good news. The Dallas Cowboys will not lose today, okay? Just throwing that out there because they don't play today, all right? So there you go, okay? But hey, let's see what God has for us. Romans chapter 12. If you're there, say, I'm there. Obviously, guys, you and I, we can all connect and we can all say, you know what, 2020 has been crazy. Right? We can all sit there and say, you know what, through the pandemic, through the division that's going on in our world today, through the election, all the things that are up in the air, right now there's just a lot going on. And how can we overcome this? How can we overcome our giants? How can we overcome this opportunity that you and I have? Is that you and I need to recognize we need to be a Romans 12 Christian, okay? And so I'm going to challenge you with four things this morning for you to be dedicated to as we face this world together, all right? So we're going to see these four things that you and I need to be dedicated to be a Romans 12 Christian, okay? Romans chapter 12, go with me to verse 1. Verse 1, look what it says. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. It goes on to say, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let's stop there for just a second, okay? The first thing I see there in verse 1, for you and I to be a Romans 12 Christian, you and I got to be dedicated to God. Everybody say, that's right. That means putting him number one no matter what, okay? We're going to unpack this, okay? We're going to unpack God's word. Why should you and I offer this body as a living sacrifice to him? Why should you and I give him everything? Why should he be number one in our life, okay? Let me show you why you and I should be a Romans 12 Christian. Keep your finger here, but turn with me to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, I'm going to show you why you and I ought to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice. Romans chapter 3, verse 20, it says there this. It says, therefore, no one be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. Check it out, church. The Old Testament law revealed to you and I three things. It reveals to you and I that God is perfect and holy. Are you with me, church? It also reveals to you and I that man is sinful. Are you with me, church? It also reveals to you and I the need for Jesus. Amen. Come on now, okay? That's what the Old Testament law did, okay? So Romans chapter 3, verse 20, that's what it talks about. Go with me to chapter 5, verse 1. I know I speak fast, sorry. It's just because my wife actually speaks faster than I do. Pray for me, okay? All right? Romans chapter 5, verse 1, look what it says here. It says, therefore, everybody say, therefore. It says, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus. So the fact is, church, watch. You and I recognize we have sin in our life, and because of that sin, we need a Savior. So when you and I run to Jesus and we put our faith in him and him alone, and we say yes to him, and it's him, it's just him, only him, it is, you know, it's just all Jesus, right? When you and I do that, we say yes to him, we ask him to forgive us our sins, we now become justified. We're now a child of God. We are now a prince and a princess to the king. Are you with me? Go watch Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Look what it says here. Again, it says, therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Praise God, right, church? So when you and I recognize we have sin in our life, we need a Savior, we say yes to Jesus, we become His, we become a child of God, and now the Holy Spirit is within us. And that gives us insurance. All right? Woohoo, baby! Okay? All right? Because of those things, check it out. Because of those steps in our life, and we have Him as our personal Lord and Savior, you and I ought to offer this body as a living sacrifice. And we ought to be a Romans 12 Christian that is dedicated to God no matter what. All right, so look what it says. It says, therefore, right? Again, we're there at Romans chapter 12. Therefore, that's why that therefore is therefore, okay? It says, I urge you. So that's a very gentle way, okay? He says, I urge you, I encourage you. Watch what he says. Brothers, in view of God's mercy. Everybody say mercy.
Mercy.
See, that is being delivered from something that you and I deserve. Amen. You and I deserve death. You and I deserve hell. You and I deserve all of that stuff. We deserve the cross. But God loved you and I to the point that He recognized we had sin in our life, and so He sent His one and only Son, Jesus, to go and take our place. Now think about what He did for you and I 2,000 years ago and what He had to go through, church. We know that for, 24 hours He had no food or no sleep. We know that they beat Him to the point that the Bible says His face was unrecognizable as a man. We know that they beat Him to the point that they whipped Him 39 times and that cat of nine tails would dig into His skin and rip His skin off, exposing His back muscles. We know that after He was whipped 39 times, now let me just throw this out there, church. The reason why they would do 39 is because in Jewish law, when they flog somebody, they would normally do 40, but they'd always stop on 39 just in case if they miscounted. The number 39 stands for mercy. You can't tell me we don't serve a mighty, powerful God, church. So after He was beaten 39 times, His face was unrecognizable as a man. We know that they took a crown of thorns, stuck it upon His head. And the scripture tells us that they took a staff and beat Him over and over in His head, driving those thorns deeper and deeper into His skull. We know that He had to carry a crossbeam that weighed about 125 pounds, 3 hours before He's going to be crucified. And as He's carrying that crossbeam, we know that they are mocking Him. They are spitting on Him. And they are taking the robe that is on Him, and they rip it off just so He had to go through the pain and suffering again. If you're listening, say, I am. After He got up on that cross, they took 6 to 8-inch nails, stuck it through His wrists and through His feet. And we know that when He got up on that cross, church, the very first thing He did was He prayed for you and I. That's amazing to me. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Wow. In the view of God's mercy, we're breaking this down. Check this out. Because of what He did for you and I 2,000 years ago, and He was willing to give His life so that you and I could have life, so you and I could give this life and give it back to Him. Right, church? Okay? All right, watch what this goes on here. Still there in Romans chapter 12. It says, brothers, in view of God's mercy, again, everybody say mercy.
Mercy.
Look what it says. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. You and I are called to give this life. Check this out. Back in the Old Testament times, in Leviticus, it gives a detailed description of when somebody, a pagan, whenever they had to come and bring mercy, they would actually take different kind of sacrifices. And what they would do is, one of the sacrifices they would do was called a burnt offering. And what they would do is they would take an animal, they would sacrifice that animal, they would skin that animal, and then they would cut it up into pieces. And then they would break it to the altar, and they would burn it up, and they would offer it to God. Now, here's my question to you, church. When they burned that offering up to God, who did it belong to? It belonged to God, okay? My question is this. When they offered that very offering to God, and it belonged to God, could they reclaim that very offering? No, because it belonged to who, church?
God.
Come on now.
God.
It belonged to God. You and I, once we come to Christ and we say yes to Him and we become His, we no longer belong to ourselves. We now belong to
God.
Come on now. We belong to God. And so that's why you and I are meant to offer this body as a living sacrifice. Because He's totally changed our life. So here's my challenge to you, and I'm going to do this in a loving way, okay? I got an illustration for you guys, okay? Everybody say priorities.
Priorities.
All right, I need Brighton and Hudson, will you guys come help me? I don't know your name, young man. Can you come help me real quick? I promise you don't have to say anything. I need two more young people to come help me. Anybody? Will you two come help me? All right, sweet. Awesome. All right, y'all spread out. You can go. All right, now I got six. It doesn't matter. Now you can go sit down, buddy. Thanks, bud, for coming. All right, cool. All right, so here we go. Check this out, okay? Here's what I want to challenge you with. You guys can see this. It says cell phone. It says God. It says family. It says work. And it says sports, okay? You guys help me out with this part. Check this out. If you look at our world today, we have problems. We have some problems with our priorities. Would you agree with me, church? We do, okay? All right, as looking at these five things, looking at as our world as a whole, what do you think most people put first in their life? All right, I heard work first, okay? So Hudson, get up here. All right, then I heard cell phone, okay? All right, so cell phone's there. What would you say third that most people put third in their life?
Sports.
Okay, boom. What do you say most people in our world today put fourth in their life? Family. Okay. Good job, buddy. He's with it. You can slide down for me. All right. So what you guys are saying as we look at our priorities, again, everybody say priorities.
Priorities.
We're saying work, cell phone, sports, family, God. Do we need revival? We do, church. Here, let's just get transparent, okay? Revival is not going to take place in our nation until it takes place in the church. It's not going to take place in the church until it takes place in who?
Us.
Uh-oh. Okay, it's us, okay? Because let's get transparent, let's get real, okay? All right? It was easy for you guys to point the finger and say, look at our world today. Look at their priorities. Now, let's look at ourselves. Those of us that are Christians, those of us that are believers, those of us who say, I am a prince and a princess of the king, and I want to live for him, and I want to give him everything. I truly want to worship him the way that he deserves to be worshipped. If we looked at our priorities, come on, let's get real. What would we say is first in our life? It should be. It should be. Good answer. Don't give me the church answer, though. Let's get real. What do we put first in our life as a Christian?
Family.
Go ahead, get up there, bub. Slide down, Hudson. What do we put second? I heard work, I heard God. Okay, so we'll put work and then we'll put God next. All right, you slide down. We as Christians, what do we put fourth in our life? Cell phone. All right, so you're there. And then sports. So what you guys are saying as a whole, okay, I know it might be a little bit different for you as an individual, but what you're saying is most Christians is family, work, God, cell phone, sports. Do we have a problem? All right, and if I'm being honest and being real with you, you're honestly telling me that cell phone is fourth in your life? Just saying, okay? I'm just saying it in a loving way, okay? Think about that, though, okay? If you and I have a sense of urgency about God's word the way we do about our cell phone, God would rock our world. I'm just throwing it out there, okay? All right, the greatest text, the greatest message you'll ever read and hear from is God's word, not your cell phone. Just hello, okay? All right, watch this. So think about this. If we ask God, what should our priorities be? What would be first? Himself, that's right. Go ahead and slide right there. What would be second?
Family,
that's right. What would be third?
Work,
that's right. What would be fourth? It'd probably be sports because he likes the Cowboys, okay? All right, and then probably cell phone. Who knows, okay? Check it out. Very simple, very basic, but I pray and hope that this will be something you'll think about. If we truly allow God to be God of our life, can you imagine what our family would be like? If we truly allow God to be God of our life, can you imagine what our workplace would be like? We wouldn't be waking up saying, man, I got to go work again today. We're going to be saying, man, I have an opportunity to be a light today. I have an opportunity to be his hands and his feet and his voice today. I have an opportunity to make a difference for his kingdom today. Can you imagine if we truly allowed God to be God of our life and he was number one in our life no matter what? Can you imagine if we used him or used that and used sports as a stage to take people to the cross? See, Brighton is in seventh grade this year, and he's getting to play football, first experience, things of that nature. He loves it. Man, I want to teach my boys that, you know what, I want them to love Jesus and give him all the glory and praise. When they get on that field, I want him to hit someone so hard that the snot comes out their nose. And then I want him to pick them up and say, you know what, Jesus loves you. Right? Can you imagine, church, if we truly allow God to be God of our life and we used technology to be able to share scripture, to be able to share truth, to be able to share the love of Christ? If this was our priorities, church, revival would be taking place. All right? And so that's something we need to examine this morning. That's something we need to look at this morning. We truly want to be a Romans 12 Christian. We got to have the right kind of priorities. Everybody say, that's right. All right, you got it going on. You guys can take those with us. That's a little souvenir for you, okay? All right, check it out. So let's keep rocking and rolling with you, okay? Because I want to get to drawing a picture for you guys. Again, we're looking at Romans 12, wanting to be a Romans 12 Christian. Why? Because of the giants we're facing in our world today, the struggles we have in our world today. What do we need to do? Be a Romans 12 Christian. How do we do that? Be dedicated to God no matter what. Go with me to verse 2. Look what it says. Do not, everybody say, do not. It says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you are able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will. Guys, that's what it's all about. Here's the thing. Check it out. You and I not only got to be dedicated to God, but we got to be dedicated to the process. It's not going to happen overnight. Okay, we want it to be done just like that. Okay, all right, it's called sanctification. We come to Christ, we're justified. Justification. Now we got to dive into God's word, study God's word, read God's word, apply God's word, share God's word, so God's word can transform us, God's word can transform our mind, and so on and so forth. We got to be dedicated to the process. All right, that means holding each other accountable. That means loving on one another. That means diving into God's word together. That means praying together. That means, check this out, guarding our heart. Come on now. All right, it tells us in 1 Samuel 16:7, it says that you and I, man looks at the outwardly appearance, but it says God looks at what, church? The hearts. We know in Proverbs 4:23, it says, above all else, in other words, the most important thing in your life, above all else, it says to guard your hearts. Why? Because that's what God cares about. That's what God looks at. Guys, let's get real. How much time do we spend on our outwardly appearance? If you're looking at me, I don't spend a lot of time, obviously, okay? All right? But we do spend a lot of time on our outwardly appearance because we want to please that person on our right and our left, right? How many have ever done this? You're in the restaurant, you go to the restroom, right? You're looking in the mirror and you're like, check out your smile. Who does it? Come on now, can't lie in church. We all do it. You're all looking like, who's going to raise their hand, right? Okay, we do that, right? Think about this. You and I'm telling you, guys, we even now, when we're in the mirror, we're like, wah. That's what we do, ladies. That's just how we are, okay? We want to check out our muscles, okay? Because that's just what, I mean, I don't know, okay? But the fact is, church, we spend a lot of time on our outwardly appearance. I'm telling you guys, as a Christian, as a Romans 12 Christian, as a prince and a princess of the king, we should do everything we can to guard our heart because that's what God's looking at. You say that, are you with me? Yes. Not only guard your heart, but watch this. As we're dedicated to the process, we should do everything we can to guard our mind. Here's the reason why. If you do not guard your mind, you cannot guard your
heart.
Hello. All right. And so how does our mind work? Think about this, guys. If you got a pencil and pen, you can write this down. If not, memorize it. I'll have a pop quiz next time I come back, okay? All right, check it out, though. Watch. Here's how your mind works. You sow a thought, and if you think about something long enough, what's going to happen is you're going to reap action. You sow action in your life, and you do it more over and over and over. Now what happens is you've sown a habit, all right? Whether it's good or bad, now that you've sown that habit in your life and you do it over and over and over, whatever the action is, it now turns into character. That character now turns into destiny. And it all started with what, church?
A thought.
So if you put trash in, what's going to come out? Trash. You put God's word in, what's going to come out? God's word. I mean, it just makes sense. You run with the skunk, you're going to smell like a skunk. Hello. Right? You show me your friends, I'm going to show you your future, okay? All right, the fact of the matter is, you and I got to be dedicated to the process, allowing God's word to be what it needs to be in our life so we can guard our heart so that we can guard our mind. Are you with me? Okay? Guard our mind so we can guard our heart, okay? What else do we need to guard? We need to, as we're dedicated to the process, we must guard our eyes. Is that an easy thing for us to do in our world today?
No.
It's not. I get it. Okay? That's just the world we live in. Okay? But know that even Job made a dedication to guard his eyes before the Lord because he knew how important that is. Why is it that important? Because if you don't guard your eyes, you can't guard your
mind.
I mean, it just all goes together. So you and I got to do everything we can as Christians to guard our eyes so we can guard our minds, so we can guard our heart, so we can worship him the way that he deserves he worshiped. Why? Because we want people to know that we are Romans 12 Christian who is totally dedicated to God no matter what, with the right priorities, because we truly want to see revival take place. Everybody say, that's right.
That's right.
All right, let's keep going on. Check this out, okay? Go with me next to, let's go to verse 4. Verse 4. Check out what it says here. It says, just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it to the proportion of his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. And it goes on to tell us, if it's leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Check this out, church. Give me your eyes. Watch this. The third thing that you and I got to be dedicated to, be dedicated to God, be dedicated to the process. Are you following me so far? We got to be dedicated to the church. I'm not talking about four walls and a ceiling. I'm talking about you and I. We've got to be dedicated to the church. We're about to face some times, I'm telling you, in this world today, we're about to be, there's a lot of things we're about to face. I'm just going to just throw that out there, okay? And it's going to be you and I together praying for one another, encouraging one another, equipping one another, lifting each other up, holding each other accountable is the only way we're going to be able to make it through this. All right? I'm telling you, church, we got to be dedicated to the church. Everybody say, that's right.
That's right.
Check this out. Watch. It's too much like my hands. All right, my family, we love sports, okay? And the fact is, if we're playing any kind of sports, your hands have to work together. If I'm playing basketball and I'm shooting the ball, my hands have got to work together. Would it not be silly, okay, if I'm out on that court and my right hand's trying to shoot the ball, but my left hand's trying to block it? You would look at me like I was crazy. Okay, you're like, dude, that guy, he needs some help, okay? He needs to be sitting on the bench, okay? He can play guard the water, okay? All right, that's probably what you're thinking, okay? All right, can you imagine if I'm trying to catch a football, but yet as I'm trying to catch the football, my hands don't work together. I would not be able to do what I need to do on that field. Something so simple as tying my shoe. If I'm trying to tie my shoe, church, but yet my hands don't work together, I will not be able to tie my shoe. You and I, much like my hands, that have to work together to be able to do the things in my life. You and I, as a church, as a body of Christ, we've got to work together. How do we do that? God's given each and every one of us gifts. Come on now. We're supposed to use those gifts, watch this, to encourage one another. You know what our world does today? We use those gifts to tear each other down. All right, I'm telling you, we got to use those gifts that God gave us to be able to encourage one another, to be able to equip one another, to be able to pray with one another, to be able to encourage one another, to be able to do what God's called you and I to do. Are you with me? Okay, it's important for you and I to be dedicated to God, to be dedicated to the process, to be dedicated to the church. Then again, that means holding each other accountable. Uh-oh. All right, going to someone in love, being able to lift them up, encourage them, taking them scripture and say, hey, man, let's look at this, right? That's part of being the church, okay? Let's keep moving forward, okay? Check this out, okay? Let me show you the fourth thing we got to be dedicated to, okay? Go with me now to verse, let's go to verse 14. We'll start at verse 14. If you're there, say I'm there. All right, you got it going on. Look what it says. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Listen in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, what does it say to do, church? Feeding. Come on now. If he's thirsty, what are we supposed to do, church? Give him something to drink. It says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Check it out, church. You and I got to be dedicated to God. You and I got to be dedicated to the process. Guard our heart, guard our mind, guard our eyes. You and I got to be dedicated to the church, loving one another, being the church that God's called us to be. Check it out. Watch. Why? Because you and I got to be dedicated to reach people who need Jesus. Our world today, there's a lot of people right now that are searching for answers, Come on now. They're looking for truth. They're wondering what direction to go. And I'm telling you, you and I, we have the answer. The answer, obviously, is Jesus, right? And it's time that you and I understand, if we truly are dedicated to God, we truly are dedicated to the process, if we truly are dedicated to be the church, we're going to have a passion to reach people for Jesus. Come on now. And that's my prayer for you guys, is that is your passion, that is your drive, that is your hunger, that you understand there's people in your life that you can reach that I can't. They expect to hear Jesus from me because I'm a minister. But when they hear it from you and they see it in your life, that's when they say, man, there's something about this Jesus deal. And when you have an opportunity, my prayer as a Christian, my prayer as a Romans 12 Christian, you'll make the most of that opportunity, taking them to the cross. If you listen, say, I am.
I am.
Does that make sense? You with me? Okay. I want to show you an illustration here, and I want to draw a picture for you guys, okay? I got four chairs here, okay? All right, now, here's the deal. Each of these chairs represents something totally different, okay? This first chair, what I call, is the seeker. Everybody say seeker.
Seeker.
The fact is, in our world today, everybody is seeking for something, okay? And what this chair represents is somebody who is lost. This is someone who is seeking after the things of the world. They're turning to money, they're turning to power, they're turning to jobs, they're turning to relationships, all that stuff. They are seeking for something that's going to fill that void in their life, and the fact is, because they look to the world, it's never going to be filled, because we know the only thing that can fill that very void in their life is Jesus. Are you with me? That is a seeker. Watch. This right here, this chair is called the follower. Everybody say follower. See, there's a huge difference between the seeker and the follower. The follower is someone who recognized they had sin in their life, they needed a Savior, they said yes to Jesus, and once you say yes to Jesus, you now become a follower of Christ. See, this person right here is destined for hell. This person right here is destined for heaven. Huge difference. All right, it is minus nothing, it is plus nothing, it is only Jesus. Are you with me? All right, once you become a follower, you are now His. Praise God. All right, now here's the deal. There's a lot of Christians who stay in this chair. Uh-oh. There's a lot of Christians who get in that chair, and they get comfortable, and they become the frozen chosen. Uh-oh. They get in that chair, and they become secret saints. They get in that chair, and they get in their little holy huddle, right? Okay? I want to challenge you and encourage you. Check this out. Check this out. So we have the seeker. We have the follower. This chair, very simple. You guys will like this. It's called the fisher. See, you and I are called to go and to be fishers of men. We all know the scriptures. We've all read it. We've all heard about it. We all have it memorized. The fact is, we are called to go share the gospel. Okay, check this out. Watch. Once you and I get to this chair right here, we are going to be burdened about that very person in that chair right there. We're going to recognize, man, I've been there. I know what they're going through. I know where they're at. I know they're turning to things of this world. And I need to do everything I can to pray for that person, to love on that person, to invest in that person, because I want that person to know that Jesus loves them, and all they got to do is make a decision to follow Jesus, to give Him everything so they can move to this chair. Right? That's my prayer, that you and I will get that point. We'll say, you know what? Yes, I'm a follower, but you know what? I also want to be a fisher. Come on now. Watch. There's this last chair. It's called the discipler. And guys, the fact is, I'm comfortable in this chair. I'm just being transparent with you. I'm comfortable in this chair. I get to go and do camps. I get to go and speak at churches every single weekend. I love what God's called me to do. And I feel like that's the gift that God's given me, to be able to share the love of Christ, to be able to share the gospel and see souls saved, lives change. And that is my passion. That is my drive. And I love doing it. I know I'm also called to be a discipler. I know I'm called to make disciples. I'm not the best at it, but that's something I want to do as well. If you listen, say, I am. Watch, church. You and I, when we get to this chair, we're looking at that person in the second chair. We're recognizing, man, that young person, or maybe that older person, they just accepted Christ. Now they're a baby in Christ. Now they're just now beginning their walk. And you know what? As a discipler, I need to do everything I can to walk beside that person, to invest in that person's life, to love on that person, to encourage that person, because I want to see that person grow up in their salvation. I want to see that person grow up in their worship and totally give Jesus all the glory and all the praise. I want to see this person totally on fire for Christ, being a Romans 12 Christian, totally dedicated to God, dedicated to the process, dedicated to the church, and dedicated to reach the lost. Because if I invest into this person's life right there, they're going to understand, I don't need to be the frozen chosen, I don't need to be a secret saint, I need to move on, continue to grow up in my salvation, and be able to share the gospel. Woohoo, baby! I guess I can get excited up in this place. Think about it. Guys, if that would be our passion, and we truly want to be a Romans 12 Christian, dedicated to reach the lost, no matter what, man, God's going to use the Double N Cowboy Church to further his kingdom. Amen. And you're going to have to blow out these walls or have multiple services or whatever. Because I'm telling you, there's people in your life, at your workplace, in your family, right now, they're searching for answers. You need to give them the answer, and that is Jesus Christ. Everybody say, I will.
I will.
Everybody say, I can.
I can.
See, it's not by chance, it's by choice. Whose choice is it? It's yours. Whether or not you're going to say, I want to be a Romans 12 Christian. Can I draw a picture for you guys this morning? Awesome. You don't got to be so like, finally he's done. Okay. All right. No. I want to draw this picture for you. Take me about 7 minutes or so. I pray and hope that it blesses your heart and it just challenges you, encourages you, and so on and so forth. So let's pray real quick. Lord, I do come before you right now. I do thank you for this morning. I do thank you for this church body. I see a lot of familiar faces. Man, it's just a blessing to be able to come and worship with them. Thank you for the worship that we have through song. Thank you for the worship that we have through your word that you tell us is active and living. I pray that for the next 7 minutes as we draw this picture, we can continue to worship you the way that you deserve to be worshiped. We love you so much. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you guys want to move, you can. If y'all want to stay there, you can. You probably won't be able to see it very well.
can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall?
Thank you.
God's the reason why you and I have the hope that we have is because 2,000 years ago, God loved you and I to the point that He sent His Son Jesus on the cross for us. But it didn't stop there, church. After He died, they put Him in a tomb. And it didn't stop there, church. On the third day, He rose again. He's alive and well today. And because He's alive and well today, you and I are alive and well today if we know Jesus is our Lord and Savior. And I got to believe that He walked out of that tomb, and that's kind of what He saw. And because, church, because He gave His life, you and I now have a chance to have life. And now we're called to give that life back to Him and be a Romans 12 Christian. Let me pray, and Brother Jimmy will come up, and I think we're going to sing a song to close. Lord, it's all about You. It's all because of You. I thank You for this church body. I thank You for this opportunity. I thank You for Your word. And I pray that this next week in my own life, I pray that in their life that we will be a Romans 12 Christian, that we will make sure that You are number one in our life, that our priorities are right. And I pray that if our priorities aren't right, this next week, as we examine our life and as we examine our relationships and examine our choices, I pray that we'll make You number one. Lord, I also pray that we will be dedicated to the process, knowing we got to do everything we can to guard our hearts, our mind, and our eyes. I pray that we'll also be the church that You called us to be. In this time that we're living in and just the struggles that people have, it's a great opportunity for us to make the most of the opportunity and make much of You. And Lord, I also pray that we'll just have a passion and a desire, not just to be a follower, but we want to be a fisher and a discipler for You. Lord, we love You so much. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Y'all give Him a hand. Y'all give Him a hand. If you're a guest with us here today, thank you for coming. We hope you come back. More importantly, if you don't have that relationship that Corey has just spent the last half hour talking about, if you don't have that, don't walk out of this building. Don't walk out of this building and get in your vehicle and leave here without that change, without that invitation being extended to you, okay? Don't leave here without Jesus. It's the best decision. It's not going to cost you anything, because just as He shared with you today, it already cost Jesus everything, okay? Don't leave here. Don't leave here without knowing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Y'all stand up, and they're going to close us in a song here. Thank you, Corey.
Have a great week.
Always try to heed my second mind.